Good morning and welcome. Welcome to Bishop Auckland Methodist Church. Welcome to all of you for coming to share with me this morning. And I wish to share with you the faith, love, and hope that we have in Jesus. Welcome to those who are listening on 105.9 Bishop FM, and welcome to those of you who are joining us on YouTube. For the first time, you can see me in dashing raspberry pink clerical polo shirt. What excitement there is for those watching. You are most welcome to our worship on a cold day here in Bishop Auckland, but it is warm, I think, in Thessalonica, and that is where some of our thoughts will go. I will warm the church a little bit by lighting a candle as we sing our first hymn, or rather as we listen to our first hymn being sung for us, Great Father of Us All. But you can sing along if you're watching on YouTube. That all those sitting in front of me are being perfectly obedient in social distancing and wearing of masks and have sanitized their hands on the way in. But will you give me permission to remove my mask?
Thank you. And then I can put on glasses and then I can see you a little bit better. Our opening prayer this morning, it reflects Black History Month, and our opening prayer comes from one of my colleagues, one of my Methodist colleagues on the Leicester West Circuit. She is superintendent of that circuit, and Reverend Novette will lead us in prayer.
Gracious and holy God, we come to you with confidence, knowing that you turn no one away. Your loving kindness is reflected in all of creation and seen most clearly in Jesus Christ. We praise you, O God, that you have made yourself known to peoples of every generation, tribe, and language. In this Black History Month, we thank you for the resilience and courage of your people, who, despite their suffering, recognize that your purpose for all humanity is justice, generosity, and compassion. We thank you that they have enriched our world with your spirit of hope. May we treasure your beauty, O God, revealed in Jesus Christ and at the heart of every human being created in your image. Amen.
Justice, generosity and compassion, faith, love and hope, wonderful virtues that we have in Christ Jesus. But even with all that, these days can feel a little bit difficult, and Hannah picks up that theme in her creative prayer.
At the moment, it can be difficult to feel joy and have strength. We can often fear that we can't regain the happiness we have experienced in good times. Today, think about tough times that you have been through. Pray for a renewal of your strength, committing your worries into God's hands. However weak you feel, trust as you pray that God's joy can be your sustaining strength.
It is having that trust, it is having that hope and faith in the love of Jesus and God to sustain us. As we gather, we think of those who are unable to gather in church. We pray for those members of our fellowship and of different local churches who would love to be in buildings, who would love to have coffee with their friends afterwards. But they are fearful. Lord, enable them to listen on the radio, to access worship in different ways, and remind them as they sit, maybe alone at home, that they are one with us in the family of God. They are one with us as we share faith, love, and yes, share hope this day. And so we are united with sisters and brothers around the world. We are united with those sisters and brothers in this town who feel isolated by themselves. We are united with the saints of the past and those who are to come. Amen. One of our saints, and we're a little bit early this week in celebrating All Saints Day, but one of our saints is going to read for us now from the Old Testament and the law of Leviticus.
Leviticus chapter 19, verses 1 and 2 and 15 to 18. The Lord told Moses to say to the community of Israel, "Be holy, because I, the Lord your God, am holy. Be honest, and just when you make decisions in legal cases, do not show favoritism to the poor or fear the rich. Do not spread lies about anyone, and when someone is on trial for his life, speak out if your testimony can help him. I am the Lord. Do not bear a grudge against anyone, but settle your differences with him so that you will not commit a sin because of him.
Do not take revenge on others or continue to hate them, but love your neighbors. Love your neighbors as you love yourself. I am the Lord." Amen. We continue on into Matthew's Gospel in the New Testament, and we hear a very similar message from Jesus.
Matthew chapter 22, verses 34 to 40, the Great Commandment. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they came together, and one of them, a teacher of the law, tried to trap him with a question. "Teacher," he asked, "which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the most important commandment. The second most important commandment is like it. Love your neighbour as you love yourself. The whole law of Moses and the teachings of the prophets depend on these two commandments.
So we've got the Old Testament tradition, the law of Moses, that spoke about loving our neighbours, that practical love and care and concern for justice among them. And Jesus picking up, saying the love of God, yes, but also loving our neighbour. And that was the message that went out with Paul and the early missionaries. And that was the message that went out to Thessalonica. They might have been a young church and just beginning their faith journey, but I hope they had that clear message about love and working to love their neighbours. We hear a little bit more about love in different ways, and love for neighbours in difficult circumstances where the neighbour could be persecuting you, as we hear from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2.
Thessalonians chapter 2 verses 1 to 8. Paul's work in Thessalonica. Our friends, you yourselves know that our visit was not a failure. You know how we had already been mistreated and insulted in Philippi before we came to you in Thessalonica. And even though there was much opposition, our God gave us courage to tell you the good news that comes from Him. Our appeal to you is not based on error or impure motives, nor do we try to trick anyone. Instead, we always speak as God wants us to, because He has judged us worthy to be entrusted with the good news. We do not try to please people, but to please God, who tests our motives. You know very well that we did not come to you with flattering talk, nor did we use words to cover up greed. God is our witness. We did not try to get praise from anyone, either from you or from others, even though as apostles of Christ, we could have made demands on you. But we were gentle when we were with you, like a mother taking care of her children, because of our love for you when we were ready to share with you not only the good news from God, but even our own lives. You were so dear to us.
And that message of love running through scriptures is illustrated in our song and in our pictures.
Oh,
For those unable to see the pictures, those of us in church were watching photographs and pictures and verses of sisters and brothers around the world, celebrating their faith, living by love, faith, and hope in their various different contexts. We travel now to Greece, to wonderful stories that are told. The first story, however, has more of a Western feel to it. It's recorded in the book, not the book of Isaiah or Jeremiah or even Luke's Gospel, the book according to Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, that well-known book of stories. It's wonderful. I discovered the sharing of this in a local library, and I borrowed this book, not knowing much about Zen or motorbikes, and I didn't discover much about either. But within it, there are stories that talk about our faith and philosophy. And one of those stories supposedly comes from South India. A story is told where there is a hollowed out coconut. And in that hollowed out coconut, there is some rice put inside, a tempting meal for a cheeky monkey. But the coconut is tied down, and the hole that the monkey can put his hand in to grab the rice is just the right size for the hand to squeeze in and grab the rice. Now, if the monkey had just wanted one grain of rice, that hand might have slipped back out. But the greedy monkey, grabbing a full handful and fistful of rice, couldn't then pull his hand back out of the coconut and was trapped there by the villages, apparently, in South India. Freedom would come. Freedom would come, according to Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. Freedom would come if we give up the greed. We would have freedom. Now, that story doesn't come from South India, despite Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance saying that it comes from there. It was told in Greece thousands of years ago, and it could have been told in Thessalonica. And it's one of those values that Paul might have picked up on. Instead of greed, instead of taking as much as you can for yourself, that Paul and his friends were being accused of, Paul said, no, that's not what we're about. We're about loving our neighbor. We're about sharing all that we have with you. We're about helping and helping in any way that we can. So let's hear another story, one from America and the grain belt this time. There was a farmer who was a prize-winning farmer. His wheat was better than anybody else's, and he would win the prizes at the agricultural show each year. And his neighbor, she asked him, why do you hand all your good seed away? You win the prize and then you give your good seed to all the neighbors around you. Why are you so generous with your seed? And the farmer let his neighbor into a secret. He told her, well, the pollen blows with the wind. If my neighbors have bad seed, then the pollen will blow across and my fields will not be as healthy and prosperous. But if I help my neighbors, if I am generous to my neighbors, if I share the best with my neighbors, then I get that back and the crop grows. I'm not sure if that works with modern day wheat varieties and genetic modification of wheat, but the truth is there. As we share rather than be a greedy monkey, as we share our faith and love, we share hope. And in these days, we need to share hope. This week, I was watching the BBC, and there was a story on the BBC about conjoined twins. Safa and Maria, if I've got their names right, who are now about 3 years old and back in Pakistan. But whenever they were being separated and their skulls were being separated, the older one, Safa, was stronger. And Mara didn't seem to have a chance of surviving and needed extra blood supply. And it was the surgeons who gave to the weaker sister a better blood supply in the brain. Unfortunately, that led to Safa having a slight stroke and being behind her sister now. But that decision of who should have most enabled both sisters to live. The girls had no choice what they would give to each other. It was a team of skilled surgeons. And our final story takes us back to America and to Rini, who was a firefighter, a veteran firefighter at the age of 52 in Los Angeles, I think. And she was a go-getter. But her brother, Kerry, had always had medical issues. And now he needed a kidney. And she said, I'll give a kidney. I will give one of my kidneys to my brother on one condition. And the condition was that she would be fit enough to get back in her fire truck and to help others also. And that story, I think, speaks about what and how we should use our faith and love to bring help to our neighbours, not to be greedy and hold on to the faith and love and hope that we have, but to share, to be ready to share with our sisters and brothers, and to be ready to share with our neighbours, whoever they are around the world in these days. And Paul commended the church to share generously as a mother generously gives to her child. We reflect on that as we listen to some music and watch some slides.
Compares to this.
Name it is. What a beautiful name it is. It is because of the love of the Lord Jesus that was generous to Paul that he went to Thessalonica and other cities to show that sharing of generosity and love and forgiveness and compassion. And he writes, because we loved you so much, we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but to share with you our lives as well, as we served in practical ways to bring faith, love, and hope. Let's pray. Lord, we pray again for those who long for somebody to bring them faith, love, and hope. Pray for those who sit in darkness, who sit on their own, who sit forgotten about, discouraged, fearful. We pray for them and their families, their neighbors, their friends. Lord, we pray for ourselves that you may prompt us, enable us to show faith, love, and hope, even whenever we are socially distant and cannot visit and join them for a cup of tea inside. Enable us to find ways of not being greedy, of not hanging on to what we have, but determined to share what is life-giving in us. Determined to share that with those around who need that life and hope brought to them this day. We pray for those who share food and thank God for those who share food through the Feeding Families initiative around Bishop Auckland and here in the Northeast. We thank God for those who work in our local food banks, and for different churches that gave their harvest tins and offering towards the work of the food bank. And for those who just drop bags of food down so that others can take stuff away and share. Lord, we thank you for the extra special bits, not only the tin of beans and soup, but the birthday cake for a young girl that can be picked up by a mother and bring delight to her family. Lord, encourage us to share, but encourage us to challenge the system when there is not that sharing, when there is not that provision for those who are in need. Lord, help us to speak up for the hungry, to speak up for those in financial difficulty, to ask and even demand for justice and righteousness and peace to go along with our faith and love and hope. And what we ask for our neighbours here in Bishop Auckland, we ask for our neighbours around the world, because we are one family in Jesus Christ, who taught us to say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our final hymn that we will listen to here in the church, and you can sing along at home if you know the words, Jesus, Jesus, fill us with your love. And the hymn, I think, was written in Ghana. Go now in the love of God. Go with faith, love, and hope. Go ready to share what you have with neighbours near and far. And come back next week. Come back to hear Reverend David Payne. I'm tempted to say a saint of a man. Come back next week as David leads us in an All Saints Day service. But go now to share, and go with the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Go in love and peace. Amen.